Alright, this is John Cola with growingyourgreens.com to have another exciting episode for you. In this episode, we'll be answering you guys' Q&As. Got your questions here. If you have a question for me, link down below my community tab where you can post a question that may appear in next month's Q&A. The weather's nice, the sun's out, it's like in the, I guess, almost hitting 60 today, might be maybe hitting 70 tomorrow. We've been in the high 50s, 60s lately. And as you can see, my garden is really pumping out. I'm glad I got most of my garden in early so that they have benefited from the nice weather, because now the temperature is dropping. The evenings are getting, being like the 40s or something, maybe even soon dipping into the 30s. I know some of you guys, their overnights are in their 20s or 30s in some northern parts of the country, which, man, I feel for you, man. I still got basil growing and a couple pepper plants growing, hanging on actually a tomato that's gonna not make it. It has currently flowers on it, I could see. Anyways, let's get into your Q&A here. Let's see, first question is from KO. I'm building a raised bed and have a question about irrigation. This bed will be 4 feet tall to accommodate some knee issues. Since my bed will be so tall, how deep should I bury my irrigation system? Should it be at root level? I intend to use Hugo culture, if that makes a difference. Additionally, I've watched your videos on irrigation systems. I was wondering if you still recommend using PVC pipe. Have you gained new insight to irrigation systems? All right, so not sure what irrigation you'll be burying. You know, I have used in the past the AquaJet irrigation, which I can no longer recommend. That does need to be buried. But I honestly, at this point, would recommend just drip irrigation that's placed on top of the soil. You know, that's how rain does it. The rain comes from above and it just hits the soil and it just kind of goes down. I would not bury the tubing, because then you won't be able to see the leaks. And I've just never really been a fan of, you know, drip tape that has been buried, although people do it. I would not put a soaker hose underneath the ground either. May have a leak. You might hit it with a garden tool one of these days and then never know you sprung a leak. I don't think that'd be too good. So I would just put it on top of the soil, actually. Oh, and then there's another garden irrigation system that's like an on-demand system. I've requested samples from the manufacturer, but they just don't respond to me. I even made them a video showing my garden so they could send me some samples, which if I had samples of this system, it basically gives the plants water as they need it, which is, I think, ideal without any intervention from a human operator. But I think the item is vaporware at this point because they haven't sent me a sample and haven't been replying to me, all right? So I'm always on the lookout for new and innovative irrigation solutions, because I think the current irrigation that is available to the public is just outdated technology. Do I still recommend using PVC pipe? That's a good question. So, you know, here's the thing, PVC pipe is cheap and available. I would rather use HDPE pipe if you could find it near you. It is probably a lot more expensive to use than PVC pipe, or if you can afford it, I would use copper pipe. I mean, that's like old school. Copper is extremely expensive, but, you know, next time I put in a garden, I might just be using copper pipe, but it depends, you know. Like, it could get very, very, very expensive. So it just kind of depends your goals. I think, you know, you shouldn't expose PVC pipe to the sun and UV. It could degrade it. So if you're gonna use it, it should be buried. Also, I would encourage you to have a water filtration system on your irrigation system as well. Next question from Ordani. Do you rotate crops? If so, can you give an example of a rotation or several rotations over the course of a year? All right, so here's the thing. I plant two crops a year. I have two seasons. I have the warm season and the cool season. Right now, you see my cool season crops. I got spinach here, red lettuce there, beets in the back, kale there, mizuna here, more red lettuce here. And so I do two rotations, and every season I try to grow something different. So, you know, if I'm growing lettuce here, you know, last season it was peppers in this bed, but then the season before that, last year this time, it was lettuce. But, you know, normally I try to plant like kale instead of lettuce in the same bed, but the lettuce performed well and I have lettuce plants I need to go in when this bed became open. You know, the back bed, you know, also had peppers in it for the summer season, but last year, this time, what did it have in there? I don't know if I can remember. But you could watch my videos. Anyway, so Here's the thing, I try to do the best I can at rotation and growing different things in the same beds, but sometimes it just doesn't happen. My goal is to always rotate and grow something different. Well, I always grow something different season to season, but year after year, I always try to, like, you know, change it up, because, you know, sometimes my kale plants might get these little caterpillar worm things that eat them, and then if I plant, you know, spinach in that bed or lettuce in that bed, those little same, you know, caterpillar things won't eat the spinach or the lettuce. They'll just eat the kale. So I always try to rotate. That being said, I'm not dependent on rotation like you would on a farm, because I'm growing in raised beds that I re-amend the soil after every grow season. So, you know, this, all these beds got topped off with like at least quarter inch, maybe half inch of soil before I replanted them, which included very high amounts of worm castings, rock dust, soil humates, insect frass, my own homemade compost, all different kinds of stuff, you know. And so I feel that I'm feeding the crops enough. In addition, after they're planted, I then foliar fed with microbes and, you know, soil humates, Mr. Fulvic, and all these different things to basically enrich my soil. The main issue for crop rotation for me is actually the pests. Pests may be existing in the soil, you know, that may come out the next year. So this especially happens with tomato hornworms. I'll get these little egg larvae things underneath the ground, and they'll just pop up. So if I rotate my beds, I might have a little bit less of the pest pressures. That being said, I think most home gardeners, we don't need to really focus on crop rotation because we don't have that many raised beds anyways. You know, just more importantly is re-enrich your beds. Next question is, on the rocks and in the soil, Michael God Bold, how long are worm castings effective in your soil? Reason I have excess right now and debate putting out before winter or holding until spring they're stored properly. You know, that's a good question. I guess the whole thing is if they're stored properly, they could maintain their benefits for longer. And then I guess you gotta ask yourself, what are the benefits of worm castings? To me, there's two main benefits of worm castings. Number one is the fertilizer value. So yeah, I mean, there's maybe a 0.5 nitrogen value and there's some minerals in there and whatnot. But the main value to me is the fungal activity and the bacterial activity that are in the castings. Those are why worm castings are important to me, not the nutritional, you know, mineral values in there. So if they're stored properly, and ideally, you know, those microbes and fungi will definitely reduce over time in my estimation. But the, like, if you just leave them in a plastic bag where they can't breathe, that's not storing it properly, you're gonna lose them faster than if you, you know, stored them properly in a burlap sack with the right moisture content, right? Would I store them 5 years? Definitely not. I mean, the worm castings I got now, I've probably had for like 8 months, and I don't like to store them that long, but the store had a sale on them, so I bought a bunch of them, and at least, you know, I have them, and at least me having them is better than not having them. But would I pay more money to, like, buy them fresher? Probably not, because I got them for cheaper. I got them for like 25% off. But I also have other worm castings that I literally just got from California that are stored properly, that were just made. It's always best, here's the thing, it's always best to put them out as soon as possible. And if you do put them out in your garden, you know, then mulch your garden over the winter if you're somewhere where it snows. But get them in the garden, you know, get plants and roots in the ground. That's the best place, honestly, to do them, unless you store them absolutely properly. I mean, if you're gonna put them in your garden before the cold weather sits in, I would definitely mulch your garden heavy with a bunch of leaves. That'll protect them and keep the microbes alive during the off season if you're not growing, which most of the country is not growing, unfortunately. Next question is from Phil H. Would like to see a 101 session for first year gardening in the Las Vegas. What would you think would be best to grow for beginners? Perhaps what is the best for privacy, and what potted plants can tolerate the heat on a balcony? Also, how close to retaining walls can one plant trees? Just bought a house in Las Vegas with a small yard, but I'd like a little lush paradise back there. Are you gonna host any gardening classes in Vegas? All right, Phil, so you got a lot of questions there. So I have a lot of videos on growing food in Vegas. I don't know if I have a 101, but you know, you could piece together like where you get the best soil, how to put an irrigation system in, how I literally built and put in this backyard garden from these round raised beds when I started with four of them, on this side or the other side, where I got concrete blocks, you know, put together to grow a raised bed garden over there. Now, the best time to grow for beginners is absolutely in the winter time, which is right now. This is the best time to grow. You should have got your probably plants in like, you know, October, November, but you could still get your plants in now. Unfortunately, most of the nurseries don't sell any vegetables this time of year, but you could still put in, you know, fruit trees. They're gonna go, most of them are gonna go dormant in the winter time, and it's a good time for you to put them in now, and then they could wake up to a nice new spring home. What is the best for privacy in potted plants that can tolerate heat on a balcony? That's a good question. You know, I don't really grow plants for privacy. I mean, along this wall I have basically fig trees, but they don't leaf out a lot. You know, I don't grow a lot of vining plants here. Let's see what vining plants that grow well. The grass jelly has grown well, plus this other Asian one that I don't know the name, but it just keeps rooting and growing everywhere. So yeah, I mean, that you might want to look more into. I don't know which ones are edible that'll do that in this climate, because that hasn't been my experience specifically. For potted plants that could tolerate heat on a balcony, like, I grow trees in pots. Otherwise, I grow some tree collards in pots in the summer. And in the shade, I also, in pots, I grow aloe vera. And I've experimented with some bellay trees. I grow Akira in pots that seem to do all right, but I need to supplemental water them. You know, my goal is to not grow in pots, because pots, especially in the heat of the summer, dry out, and in the arid climate, dry out extremely fast. And that could be a lot of work. How close to retaining walls can you plant trees? Yeah, so if you mean the concrete block walls, like, so my trees when I bought the property are planted like 2 feet from the wall, maybe even, yeah, like less, like a foot from the wall. And I would do that again. I mean, some of the figs that I'm growing in pots are gonna get planted right next to the wall, because I have a small area. It's only like 4 feet wide. I'm gonna plant it close to the wall because I want the roots to go underneath the wall to the other property. And I want the tree to grow tall and expand its reach out. Let's see here. Yeah, so then gardening classes in Vegas. I had teached a couple gardening classes in Vegas. I hope to do it once again when I have a location to do so. And the climate in general, not like the actual climate, but the climate of the world kind of sifts, cools off a little bit. All right, next question is from LC. Easiest way to turn kitchen scraps into compost to grow container vegetables on an apartment deck? Don't want a worm bin, thanks. Well, that's a good question, man. Like, without a worm bin, like, you need to break down the compost somehow. And if you want to make it into compost, that's gonna be very challenging. So you could do bokashi composting, which is basically fermentation, but that is not a finished compost that you could directly apply to potted soil. You know, you have to still have a finishing part where it's actually physically composted. I think maybe a compost tumbler, you know, that you could tumble your compost, but then that can get messy and stinky. I mean, probably the easiest way to do that, if you just have vegetable kitchen scraps, is, you know, I would probably just put them in the oven at a low temperature to basically dehydrate them, and then put them in a blender and grind them up. Or you can get the food cycler or Vitamix food cycler, which basically does that. Now, be aware, that does not make compost. That just makes dehydrated food scraps that have been powdered up into little powder pieces that you could add as a small percentage to your potted plants, because that'll act as a food source for your microbes. That being said, an easier way to do it, depending on how many food scraps you generate, is just have a lot of growing area and, you know, containers with soil, and dig a hole and bury your food scraps every single time, and make sure you have worms in those containers. Now, if you're scared of worms, or maybe you're vegan, you don't want to keep worms because that's entrapping them, you know, or whatever things you're going through. Like, you got to do basically a heat-based compost. You know, they made some things for your kitchen in the past to like heat up and add wood pellets, but they went off the market. You know, I don't even know if any of those are still existing. But then I tried one of them and they didn't really work that good. So, I mean, basically find a local farm that's gonna compost for you, give them your food scraps and get some compost from them. I think that's a lot easier. Next question is from Wizards. Any tips on how to grow ginger and turmeric, and what strains do you prefer? I will try my first go at it when spring comes around. All right, Wizard. So ginger and turmeric need really long growing seasons. So if you just, if it gets warm in the spring and then you plant it for one season, it may not be quite long enough. So you might have to start even before the springtime. And you know, I haven't had the most experience because I don't live in a tropical environment that is conducive to growing easily ginger and turmeric. I have experimented with ginger and turmeric in the past, and my honest opinion is that you should try different cultivars to see what grows best in your specific climate zone. If you're going to start in the spring, I don't know if you live in a tropical environment like South Florida or Hawaii or Puerto Rico would be perfect places in the U.S. or even some parts of South Texas like Brownsville where you have really warm weather. I mean, here in the Southwest, I haven't had the best of luck growing ginger and turmeric. It just doesn't seem to like the dry, excessively hot weather here from my experience, but I might be wrong. And what I would recommend is try different varieties of ginger and turmeric. I know there's lots of different kinds of turmeric out there because I buy turmeric and I can taste the difference in it. I visited turmeric farms. Not sure if there's a lot of different ginger kinds. I'm sure there are some, but try them all and see which one grows better for you. Also, if you're in a short season area where you're just gonna try to grow it over the summer season, try to look for short season varieties of ginger and garlic. I'm not aware of any. Maybe there's some out there that take a little less time, but yeah, that's my tips. Good luck. All right, May Blake's campsite for tree seekers. I live in an apartment that faces the woods and want to grow some crops out there. Number one, what sort of information do I need to know to ensure that any crops I plant won't become invasive species to the local area? Number two, is the dirt outside likely to be fertile enough on its own? All right, May, so ensure crops won't become invasive species to the local area. That's a lot deeper than most people would ever think. So I commend you for that thought. That being said, it, in my opinion, depending on what you're growing, it's highly likely that whatever you grow on your balcony will become an invasive species, all right? So here's the thing. You don't want to let things on your balcony get out to nature. So how are your plants going to literally escape your balcony? Well, if they go to seed, produce seed, and then the seeds drop and then spread out, then that could become an invasive species. If a plant cutting, and certain plants could do this, if you cut a plant off, like you're growing water spinach, and then you drop it off your balcony and it falls onto the sidewalk and then rain washes it into the, you know, the creek behind your house or into the forest behind your house, then it could take off. So make sure no plant particles, whether seeds or cuttings, leave your balcony, and then you, in my opinion, won't have an invasive species because they won't be able to get out. Now, if you're growing the same plant on your balcony that's grown in the forest and you have some pollen, it may pollinate a plant in the forest, but I don't think that's an issue either, because there's always that plant growing in the forest and you're just going to create more genetic diversity. Like, we all like spreading our seeds, if you know what I mean. And I need to spread my seeds some more. All right, so number two, is the dirt outside likely fertile enough on its own? So I guess the question is, to grow what? Obviously the dirt outside in the forest is good enough to grow the forest plants, but is it enough to grow vegetables? I mean, what is the dirt outside? Is this the dirt outside, the stuff in the parking lot of your apartment complex, like that's been, you know, bulldozed and all this stuff? I would say no. If you go in the middle of the forest and dig up some nice, rich, black, deep humus, it's highly possible that it's gonna be good enough to grow food. That being said, I would also enrich it because I don't know what's in there. I would put rock dust, I would put trace minerals, and I would add some additional microbes just to ensure that my plants are gonna be successful. I would probably also add some kind of nitrogen organic-based fertilizer or my own compost in addition. A more prudent approach might be to like buy some good organic potting soil and mix that 50-50 with some good native dirt soil from the middle of forest that's basically underneath, you know, a big stack of leaves that's just brown, rich, or even better yet, black. I think that'd be the most prudent thing to do because now you got the best of both worlds. Next question is from the weirdo. Can you use turmeric to bring back a plant that has stem rot? I've never heard of that. And if you can, more power to you. And if you do, make a video. That being said, if your plant has stem rot, the only thing to me that's gonna heal that is, number one, remove the actual rot. Rot begots rot. This happens a lot with my fruits and things, but same thing with my outside. You know, our plants make compounds to fight rot. They don't want to sit there and rot, but there are conditions that are causing that plant to rot. Maybe you're overwatering it's causing it to rot. You need to remove the rot, prevent and stop the thing that is causing the rot in the first place. Maybe too much rain, it's too wet, you know, I don't exactly know, maybe it's too foggy. I mean, maybe there's some bacteria or microbes. So then the next thing is remove the rot. Number two, you wanna kill the bacteria, virus, fungus, pest that's causing the damage in the first place. You know, if it was me, I'd probably use some kind of microbe to fight the other microbes, like put some good microbes on there, beneficial microbes. And I don't know exactly what kind of microbes to use. I have these different microbe inoculants for different kind of diseases and all this crap, but I'd probably just spray a bunch of microbes on there. If you don't have microbes, just spray some compost tea and keep it dry. And maybe even some enzymes that might degrade some of the rot crap. And that's what I'd do personally. Would it work? I don't know. It depends on how the rot is. Next question is from Lillian Walker. I'm in Tucson, Arizona, 9A. What greens should I be planting this fall? We're still in the high 80s. So this probably question was about a month ago. And you should plant what I'm planting. So every winter season, fall season, I make videos about what I'm planting. I just made a video on this channel, what I'm planting for the fall winter garden. You should plant those exact plants in your climate will do better than they do here because you stay about 10 degrees, maybe about the same. Maybe a little bit warmer or maybe the same as I do. All my plants will easily survive even like a snow like they did last year, light frost or freezes, and easily does well in the weather. That being said, you want to get your garden in as early as possible. You know, if you haven't planted yet, do it this weekend, do it right now. We want to get things in before it starts getting too cold out. I mean, the best time is probably like October. Actually, when it's in the 80s is when you should have planted. 90s is still too hot. All the leafy greens, you know, snap peas I plant at that time. Any kind of leafy greens, man, brassicas, lettuces, onions, garlic, all those things are great to plant right now. Critical thinking. I like salad greens, but I dislike the maintenance of growing them, especially controlling pests. Would hydroponics be the best solution? Also, how do you see the future of backyard farming? Do you see Disney's hydroponic being the future or farm bots, for example? I enjoy watching your channel. You're so inspirational. All right, critical thinking. So, controlling pests. Will hydroponics be the solution for controlling pests? Well, in my opinion, hydroponic plants can be even more affected by pests than soil-grown plants grown in the same environment. So for example, you know, if you grew hydroponics like right where I have these raised beds, it'd probably be more full of pests because the hydroponics are not providing as wide a variety of nutrients and or microbial influences that my garden soil would, provided you have good garden soil and are, you know, properly feeding your garden soil. I'm not a big fan of growing hydroponics. And if you're gonna grow hydroponics indoors, of course, that'll curtail all the garden pests, but you could also grow in, you know, like a soilless medium indoors and grow more organically and also have no pests. And that's more about, you know, growing indoors and keeping the pests out versus growing outdoors. So just because it's hydroponic doesn't mean you're gonna get less pest pressures. Right, hydroponics to me, you gotta manage things a lot more than you do with your soil. You gotta test the pH, you gotta give all the fertilizers at the right time. Man, that to me, that's just too much work. I'd rather just blend up a good soil mix and plant my plants and put my irrigation system on that waters them once in a while and forget about it. Forget about it. So much easier, man. I think the other thing is you should just grow microgreens that are done inside. They're even more nutritious than salad greens. That'd be a better use of space because hydroponic, like lettuce, could take quite a long time, but hydroponic microgreens could be done in 7 to 10 days. And the future of backyard farming, do I see hydroponics taking over? Absolutely not. It's just too much work and too hard for the common person to do unless you're kind of more technical and all this kind of stuff and like building contraptions. I mean, just planting in the dirt, bringing in some compost, building some raised beds, super simple, super easy. Farm bots, yeah, they're nice and handy, but honestly, people just need to get outside more and do more actual work themselves instead of worry about these robots that are gonna grow our food for us. I mean, what are you gonna do? You're gonna have a farm bot growing your food so you can be a couch potato and watch more Raiders lose on TV or whatever. I mean, no, man, we should be out in nature getting the sun, you know, moving our body, bending over, harvesting stuff, growing stuff. I mean, this is how we're supposed to get our hands in the dirt. Very important, man. In hydroponics, you have all those nice microbes that could basically give us and provide us better health, right? So that I hope the future of home farming is doing what I'm doing. That's why I'm sharing this and have been sharing it on YouTube for, I don't know, 11, 12 years now. I want to show what is possible in a standard American tract home, because most people in my city, you know, live in tract homes, and most people around the country live in tract homes. Most people don't have acreage to grow food. You can grow a lot of food in even your tract home, even if you don't want to do a lot of work. I've had videos on how people do that. I mean, I put a little bit more work in it than others because this is very important to me, but I want everybody in America watching this to grow some food, even if it's in a raised bed, even if it's some sprouts or microgreens inside your kitchen. And actually, maybe that's the future of food in America, man. Everybody taking responsibility and growing some sprouts or microgreens inside because they don't want to be out cold in the wintertime. All right, next question from Alejandro Remigio. What's the best organic solution for caterpillars? They're destroying my boogie brew grown cannabis and don't want to add chemicals. Thank you. All right, Alejandro. So actually, from Boogie Brew, I like to use pure protein for my caterpillars. John, pure protein is like a protein spray from fish. Why are you spraying that for caterpillars? Because it contains BT, Bacillus thuringiensis, that'll kill caterpillars. So not only do I feed my plants with the, you know, the protein or the amino acids, they also get some BT to prevent, and I spray it on my tomatoes and peppers so I don't get the hornworms on my tomatoes and peppers. And if I just spray it often enough, it works. It's probably a bit too late to do that, but you could also get a BT standalone product and surely spray that on there. Or, I mean, surely the best way to do it is just go around into it. I mean, you can't have that many cannabis plants if you're a home grower, right? Unless you're doing it illegally, which I do not condone or advocate. Is just go around with a damn magnifying glass and go around and check out every single bud by hand and pick those motherfuckers off and then eat them. Yes, you can eat caterpillars. I don't think they taste too good, but you could eat them and show them who's boss. All right, next question is from Susan. I need to get a new compost tumbler. After many years, my drawer 270 is rusting at the seams. Do you still recommend that brand? All right, Susan, so my drawer is also, depending on, some of them rusted at the seams also. When I contacted Jor about this, they had replaced my rusted panels under warranty for me. And I asked them, hey, what about my people that I recommend your composter to? Will you replace it for them? And I really didn't get a straight answer from them. So what I recommend for you is to send them pictures of what happened to your tumblers. You know, they claim to me that they had some issues with their powder coating and it was causing issues. Now they replaced those panels and I'm having other panels rust, but not the replacement panels. So go figure. So request new panels from them and see what they say. Maybe they'll send them to you for free like they did for me. Maybe they'll charge you a little bit of money, but I think that's a far better deal to keep what you have if it works and to not have to replace it. Actually, I've had a bigger issue with the stupid foam stuff dropping out of the doors. That's been a pain in my ass. But yeah, I like the steel, I like the insulation. There's just still a few things they need to work out, including the rusting issue and the stupid panels popping out, you know, of my doors, just the heat here, the extreme temperatures, and they're just glued on with some crappy glue that just comes undone and they freaking warp, and every time I open the thing, they fall off, and it's just stupid. But I still like them. And here's the thing, what are the options? I guess the options are plastic tumblers, and most of them are just complete garbage. And if you are gonna get one, actually, I now can recommend one single lifetime compost tumbler. It's the one that's kind of concave. That's the only one I'd recommend. A lot of the other ones are crap, but this one actually, it works good. And it's not quite insulated like the Jura, but it's plastic. It won't rust, although I've had some of the hinges and stuff, the clips rust, but it's a good tumbler, man. It lasts. So that's the other one I'd recommend as a backup if you did need to get something different that's not gonna rust on you. Unfortunately, there has not been a lot of innovation in compost tumblers. There's just a lot of Chinese companies making cheap knockoff pieces of garbage that are just far too small and don't work well. They're sold at big box stores these days and even some nurseries. All right, next question is on Tyler. Any future videos on gardening, mushrooms? Yes, I'm gonna visit a local mushroom farm here. You know, one of these days I wanna grow mushrooms, but in my climate, because it's so arid, it can be more difficult and takes a lot of time, and time is something that is not on my side. I have very little time to spend with all my plants. Nonetheless, I can't babysit mushrooms. I'll have to find a partner one day that loves taking care of mushrooms and microgreens and sprouts. So if you're her and you can still have kids, contact me. All right. Next question is from Pacholo. Are you gonna do a how to grow cannabis indoors? So I already have a video on how to grow cannabis indoors. Links down below to those videos that I visited an organic cannabis farm and have videos about that topic already. I always try to make more videos about cannabis, which is another amazing food and medicine crop, and sharing with others how to grow it and to, you know, reduce some of the stigma that's out there about the cannabis plant. I mean, there's industrial hemp. I've also had videos on as well that has no, psychoactive or intoxicating effects that I'm also a big advocate of. I currently do not grow any myself due to its, federal legal status. And actually, even in my state, I'm not technically able to grow it legally either. All right, Jake from State Farm. Is that really Jake from State Farm, like the dude in the commercial? All right, how can I create good fungi in my soil? Okay, the answer is have fun girls in your soil. No, just kidding. So the answer is we need to get the fungi in there. And how can you get good fungi in there? Well, there's many ways. There's many different kinds of fungi. So easiest way is, of course, go to your local hydroponic shop and get some good mycorrhizal fungi to put in your soil and inoculate your roots with them as you plant your trees and your vegetables and anything you plant in your garden. That's number one. Number two is get a fungal dominated compost. That can be extremely hard to find unless you're in the Houston area. Then there's a cool composting facility that makes the stuff down there. I made videos about that, link down below if I remember. Can be very hard to find a fungal dominated compost that you could buy. You could mail order online at great expense. Hydroponic stores no longer sell it. I was getting the Alaskan humus that is no longer available. It was discontinued. I'm trying to get Josh from Boogie Brew to bring that stuff in. So add that. Next way is to add some good quality worm castings. All worm castings are not created equal. Some worm castings could have good fungal counts in there, and then you could add those to your garden or brew a tea. The next method is to make your own. So get wood chips for free and just pile them down and let them sit for like 3 years, right? You may want to inoculate them with something like King Strepharia mushrooms, or, you know, depending on where you live, fungus may find their way into there and start to just break it down, because that's their food source, man. If you like left pizzas out that said free, you would come a run in and probably grab them on the street, right? Yeah, leaving wood chips down, it's an encouraging fungus to come and colonize it and break it down, because that is what they love to eat. And probably the final thing I'm going to say about adding fungus to your soil is do all them that you are able to do, right? Make some compost teas out of the fungal dominated soil, as well as the worm castings, you know, with like a workhorse tea recipe or Boogie Brew compost tea. Spray that on your garden regularly. That'll help encourage fungal action in your soils. You know, depending on where you live too, like in my climate, if I water a little bit more and not allow my soils to dry out, that'll encourage more fungal than not. And even in the winter when it gets way more wet, I'll even have mushrooms coming out, which is a sure fire sign that you got some fungal activity. I don't want to see if you have a diversity of fungal activity in there, but you definitely got some fungus in there. All right, the last question from Albi Koo Cobbs. What can I do with pests that is full organic and won't show in the taste of my tomatoes? Even potassic soap can change the flavor. Please help. I use the other methods like traps and plant associations, but pests in my city are hell and summer is coming. All right, Albi. So, you know, here's the thing. Number one is go out there every second of the day and pick them off, right? Pick off the pests, smush the pests. You see aphids, smush them on the leaves, right? That's not gonna add any taste to your plants except for the, you know, their bug stomachs that are being smushed all over. Pick them off, you know. High pressure, blow them off, spray them with water, right? Those are ways that are gonna not, that are organic, that are not gonna affect the flavor or taste. Other than that, you know, soaps, neem oil, all these things that people normally spray will have some effect. I mean, maybe if you sprayed, there are bacterial inoculants that will be effective against certain pests. So like BT, like I mentioned earlier, are good for caterpillars. And there's certain other bacterial inoculants that you can spray on food that we will probably not taste that will negatively affect the pest and control them for you. I mean, I think the final thing I'm gonna say is I want you to do something that's gonna actually make your plants taste good, taste better, but won't have any residue on your plants. And what I'm gonna say is this, and it's kind of too late to do it this season, but maybe next season you could start doing this, is you wanna increase the health of your soil to increase the health of your plants, right? The pests are only attacking your soil because they are weak plants, right? If you're like a guy and you're trying to like pick up like a 200 pound dumbbell, but you're skinny bony and you're not that strong, you know, you can't pick it up. But if you've been working out every day and if you're an Olympian and you're still pretty skinny, but those people in the Olympics, man, are not like big fat dudes that are with big muscles like you see in the gym, you know, that pick up all the girls, but they're like skinny dudes that look like me that like freaking lifting 200 pounds of stuff because, you know, they're eating properly, they're working out all the time, and you don't need to be big to be strong, right? It's all about strength to body weight ratio. But anyways, I'm digressing. Anyways, if you have healthy plants, you know, they will not get attacked because the proteins will be too complex in there and the bugs cannot digest complex proteins, but we can. They're digesting simple protein, simple amino acids and carbohydrates in your plants because they're not that healthy. So you can look up Hybrix Gardens in the US and they have a complete program that you could do all these foliar sprays, you could add all these things to your soil. I mean, I don't go that far to grow, you know, the most nutritious plants and dial it in perfectly because I don't have the time to, and it can get quite expensive, but that's how you could make your plants taste better and be immune to pests, right? That's the goal. Now, I do this to a lesser degree and a better degree than most gardeners out there by adding things like the insect frass, like the worm castings, like spreading compost tea. I even have beneficial, you know, pests to spray on my plants to kill bugs. I'll use high pressure water. You know, I'll do things to increase the quality of my plants. I filter my water so that I don't get pest pressures in the first place. I'm not perfect. And I get some pests, but I'll have outbreaks. This bed will have an outbreak, but the one next to it won't. And, you know, it'll be just all weird. I don't exactly know why pests get certain plants. Maybe they just like those plants. And my tree collards have some white flies, but nothing else in my garden has white flies right now. So then I'll selectively treat that and then try to like put more, you know, insect frass and top dress in that bed and put some compost tea, brew some compost tea and put insect frass in right before I harvest it and then spray that on there. I mean, there's these little things you can do to increase the quality and the health of your plants so that they could create their own immunity, because nowhere on earth did they ever have to spray organic pesticides to control pests. The plants always done it themselves if the plants were grown in their native soils that they grew up with. But we've deranged, bulldozed the topsoils and we're growing a lot of plants not in their native climates anymore, and there's pests that they hadn't have to deal with. So we need to up our games as gardeners, and that's what I would encourage you guys to do. That's the pretty much end of this episode. If you guys enjoy this episode, hey, please be sure to give this video a thumbs up and be sure to share this with other gardeners that you guys could think it could help. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so it's out on my new and upcoming episodes that I command every 5 to 7 days. You never know where I'll show up or we'll be learning on my YouTube channel. Also, make sure you click the bell so you get notified as many videos come out. And finally, be sure to check my past episodes. The past episodes are a wealth of knowledge. Over 1,600 episodes at this time on this YouTube channel, dedicated to teach you guys all about growing your own high quality, nutrient dense food at home. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.